A very warm welcome, and it's 8:30 on a Wednesday evening, and it's the Cancer Academy time. And today, after doing, you know, 3 months of tutorials, we move on to a surgical topic. And amongst us today, we have a surgeon of not only repute, but of international fame, who will talk to us of a very contentious topic and a topic which he has mastered. Not just with numbers, but also with the academics, and he has multiple publications to show for it. Today, we'll be talking about HIPEC, or the hyperthermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy associated with metastatic cancers that we come across multiple sites. And I'm sure at the end of this talk, we'll be much more richer, we'll be much more wiser, and it will help us in decision making. The topic should be of interest to all us surgeons, definitely, and also a lot of our medical oncologists and radiation oncologists, where we often come across these questions that how can a surgical treatment help a metastatic patient. And to help us in taking those decisions, we have none other than Dr. Som Shekhar with us. Before we move on to the speaker himself, as a ritual, we have a small quiz. And that quiz has been prepared by Dr. Sanjeev. Dr. Sanjeev is an alumnus of TMH Hospital, Mumbai, and he's a dear colleague, and he'll be co-moderating this session today. May I now request Dr. Sanjeev to switch on his mic and his camera to go ahead with the questions of the quiz. I will share the quiz questions with all of you. Sanjeev, are you there?
Yeah, I'm very much
here. Hi, Sanjeev. Just a second till I open the quiz questions. So, Dr. Geeta has not logged in till yet. I think she should be here. So, the quiz format is such that we request all of you to reply to all these questions in form of, Dr. Jitesh, I'll just share the phone number with you. So, the format of the quiz is that we request you to share the quiz answers through a WhatsApp message to this number 9953621242. This is our permanent Cancer Academy number, and we request all of you to send your answers to this number. And the answer should be sent in this format: write your name, the name of your institute, and then write the correct sequence of answers. There are multiple choice 5 questions, each of them having only one correct answer, and you have to answer all of those questions together in one message. Do not send 5 separate messages, send one message in this format. Write your name, write your institute name, and the correct answer. Okay, so Sanjeev, are you ready? Should I show the first question?
Yeah.
Okay, Sanjeev, here you, read about it.
So the first question is, which is the best modality to assess PCI, peritoneal carcinomatosis index? PCT scan, a hybrid PET CCT scan, MRI scan, or laparoscopy? You can text the answers. So quiz, second number question. What is the extent of peritonectomy in CRS? 1, always total. 2, depends on the extent of peritoneal involvement. 3, depends on the histology. 4, both B and C. Moving on to the next question. What is the optimal duration and temperature during HIPEC? 1, 38 to 40 degrees Celsius for 120 minutes. Number 2, 42 to 43 degrees Celsius for 120 minutes. 3, 38 to 40 degrees Celsius for 90 minutes. 4, 42 to 43 degrees Celsius for 90 minutes. Next question, which is the landmark trial favoring HIPEC in ovarian cancer in post-NACT setting, that is during interval cytoreduction? 1, Profilochep. 2, PRODIS-7 study. 3, the study by Vandrell et al., published in NEJM 2018. And 4, RENAPE. Next question. What is the chemotherapeutic agent used for HIPEC in colorectal cancer? 1, oxaliplatin. 2, mitomycin C, 3, both, 4, none of the above.
All right, so that's the five questions for you, and we request you to send your answers on this number. I repeat the number 9953621242. It's a pretty straightforward quiz. I don't think Sanjeev put really a googly there, but still, I think it will be a surprise to see how many of us get it right. This I have put the number in the chat box, and now you can send your answers, and we will consider all those answers sent within the next couple of minutes only for consideration for the right answer. Okay. So with this, may I now invite our speaker for today, Dr. Somshekhar sir, to please switch on his camera and his mic. Sir, you are a co-host and you can share your screen as well. Sir, just a reminder that this session is being aired live on YouTube as well. And as you have rightly mentioned that we have reached 100 participants already, and that is all because of your charismatic nature that we have such a crowd today. And I am sure all of us will benefit from this. Thank you so much, sir. And you can start sharing your screen, sir.
Thank you very much, Shubham and Geeta. It's pleasure and honor to be there for the Cancer Academy for a talk which is very dear to me, my colleague, my team, Dr. Rohit, Dr. Ashwin, Ramya, and Dr. Priya, who runs a PIPAC research program with us, our entire team of residents, team medical onco and radiation. It's a pleasure. It's a topic which we have spent a lot of time, about 7-8 years of original work. And it's 8:30 and I'm amazed so many people have logged in, and then, in a matter of 15 minutes, we are houseful here. But those who cannot log in, please also, there is a link on the YouTube. There are over 250 people who are there, so you can log in and go there. If accidentally any of you disconnects or leave, then you will not be able to re-enter, because for 100, another 100 are waiting to join. So unless you want to go back on YouTube to watch, try not to log in. Otherwise, there is a seat already booked for that. A lot of my close and dear friends, Dr. Jagannath Deekshit, Rudra, Bafna, all of them have already logged in. So they are stalwarts themselves. It's an honor to share my experience. So the talk of today is from basics to recent advances, because I know that there are medical students, there are trainees, there are senior people, and very, very senior people better than me and my senior colleagues. Dr. Rama Joshi, all of them who themselves have done a lot of IPECs are there. Dr. Bafna, then, and Dr. Rudra, Dr. Jagannath Deekshit. So I decided, even though 80% of my talk, I'm going to keep it basics. It is a very, very important for me to also understand that, in knowledge, there is nothing called half and full, You can pick up how much you want. Entire talk is based on my experience, my publication, and my presentation. So you can take whatever is basics. And for people who are well beyond the basics, you can take it up. And senior colleagues of mine, I'll give some tips of our recent research. So there are three components in this particular talk. First, it's very important to understand carcinomatosis peritoni, very advanced cancer, called as a group of peritoneal surface malignancy. What it means? If you don't understand this, everything is stage 4, non-curable, then there is no fun on treating, because age-old oncology training, stage 4, no cure. No cure means palliation. Then this doesn't hold good. But how the advances in the medical oncology and the medical fraternity changed a non-curative stage 4 into stage 3 and sometimes stage 2 and curative option. So the concept is PSM, peritoneal surface malignancy. So my first part, I'm going to concentrate on that, which is extremely basics and very important for student. Second part, how do we remove this by a surgery called a CRS, cytoreductive surgery, second component, and an evidence-based, what is its important? Third component is the introduction of why chemo and heat in the tummy. Then fourth would be its role in various cancers and the morbidity, then how to put it right. Because in medicine, there is nothing called one size fits all. If somebody says absolute yes and no in oncology, is a big fool. There is nothing called absolute yes, absolute no. It is to be flexible, personalized, case-to-case basis, based on the setup you practice, based on your expertise, based on your experience. So I bring warm regards from my team. I would like to start with this most important wording of Hippocrates. those diseases which medicine cannot cure, you know that what would cure actually? Iron cures. That is what Hippocrates told. Those which iron cannot cure, fire cures. Kindly note, heat has come already there. Those which fire cannot cure, then they are called as incurable. Means a peritoneal surface malignancy, stage 4, before you call it inoperable, incurable, please pass through the heat of hypec and then rule out it is inoperable. This is a very good apt thing which I really like, which you need to know. This is a warm regard from Manipal Comprehensive Cancer Center. Our team, huge team, Dr. Vijay Ahuja, Dr. Ashwin, Dr. Rohit, Dr. Ramya, one of our very renowned, very, very, very intelligent student fame. It's honor for teachers like us to have a student like her, and excellent work by her. And Dr. Amit, lot of them, I can't name Dr. Prasanna. He was my resident who started a lot of building up this, many of them. So this is a combined work of all of them, which I'm going to do. Now, why this PSM? So much so that we have a society called as ISPSM, Indian Society of Peritoneal Surface Malignancy, ISPSM.org, you can visit. Registered body which encompasses this to coordinate the research. There are 267 centers in India doing HIPEC, about 18 centers doing more than 50 to 60 a year, few centers doing more than 100 a year. And lot of people who are picked up. So, and this is a collaborative research work. A lot of publications are happening. You can be a member of this and utilize the benefit of academics. Now, what do we really mean by peritoneal surface malignancy? This is an abdomen. There are three aspects which happen in abdomen. Remember, we don't always sleep. We stand, we sit, we jump, we climb stairs. Constantly abdomen and its organ are in relative motion with respect to each other. Gravity, tumor cells will fall down. We all have about 30 to 40 ml of fluid normally. And when you have any irritation, inflammatory or malignancy or any peritonoscopy done, any intervention, gravity brings down the cells. Second, respiratory movement. So diaphragm keeps moving. And then most important thing is we have got a falciform ligament around the superior coronal ligament where there is a stasis. Then we have bowel peristalsis. So imagine it is like a mixture, concrete mixture happening. So this increases the implants in the subdiaphragmatic area above the liver and diaphragm commonly. In the lesser sac, because of the peristalsis pumping through the foramen of Winslow. Mesentery, especially proximal mesentery. The diaphragm, it keeps moving. And then the paracholecystectomy. So you must understand that this is the whole concept of peritoneal surface malignancy we have. This is very important to understand. When there are research done in a mice, you can see that this is a lab mice. When they put any of the cell and heat and flow, and when they throw the fluorescence, what human eye thinks there is nothing spread, there will be million of small miliary peritoneal deposits all over the abdomen. So this is something very important to understand. A normally looking peritoneum may look normal to you, but there would be disease which is harboring. That's why peritonectomy as a part of cytoreduction has come. So this is very important to understand. In peritoneal surface malignancy, there is nothing called pelvic confined disease. Even a stage 1 capsule intact ovary could harbor peritoneal disease. Even then, they have 20% recurrence, even though you can remove everything and give chemo. So when you throw a fluorescence or you give ICG, throw the ICG camera, you'll be surprised to see the deposit. So what is peritoneal surface malignancy? Why such miliary, million type of, what it looks like a miliary TB, but malignancy happens? It is a group of malignant diseases which predominantly confines itself to abdomen, involving the peritoneum, both parietal and visceral. Remember, only 20% of peritoneum is parietal, 80% is visceral. Without major extra abdominal systemic metastasis or visceral involvement. That's why this group, even though it is stage 4, liver deep parenchyma, spleen parenchyma, lung parenchyma, systemic mets are not there. They die of obstruction, cancer cachexia, ascites, painful death, even though it is not because of systemic metastasis. That's why loco-regional control, even if they may not have overall survival impact, is very important in peritoneal surface malignancy to keep the gut intact so patient can eat as long as they are alive. And manipulation of sequential immunotherapy chemo can be done if you can keep the gut intact. So there is a dissemination, implantation of cells in the peritoneal cavity resulting in significant morbidity without metastasis. If there are systemic metastasis in that disease, it doesn't fit into a peritoneal surface malignancy, then loco-regional treatment is not going to cure them. Systemic therapy is important. That's why every disease has a group which behaves like PSM. So this is the commonest site, and it is a poor prognostic indicator. Chemo penetration in general in all peritoneal surface malignancy except ovarian cancer is very poor. Even in ovary response, 80% it recurs. Most of the institution, even though they do very good surgery for ovary, in 7 to 11 months biochemical failure, less than 20-30 months microscopic failure, and most of them don't see a light of 5 years. So which are the disease which contributes peritoneal surface malignancy? It is divided into primary and secondary. Primary is arising from the peritoneal cavity, peritoneum, that is mesothelioma, benign, borderline malignant, and malignant. So then you have different types of mesothelioma, which would be, you know, epithelioid variety, then mixed variety, and sarcomatoid variety. Then peritoneal carcinomatosis, PPPPC, primary, papillary, peritoneal carcinomatosis. Secondary, the problem is not with peritoneum, from the colon, from the gut, from the pancreas, from the stomach, and comes, are gynecological, benign ovarian tumor ruptured, or a mucinous tumor of the ovary ruptured, or a pseudomyxoma, not systemic metastasis, borderline malignant, or appendix, or ovarian cancers, and there are some other which are hepatoid variety, then any other rate. This is the classification. How do we know what it constitutes? This is a very important paper, which I was honored to also be an expert and co-author. From a current practice and incidence of CRS HIPEC by a PSOGI group, Peritoneal Surface Oncology Group International, 19 experts from the world were invited. I was honored, was the only one invited from Asia, from 19 different countries, and there is an answer. They called a center which does very high volume HIPEC, and our hospital Manipal was a part of it, 430 centers. Published in EJSO, you can go back and read what it told. Top five causes for peritoneal surface malignancy. You know, I put male and female. Ovary, colorectal, unknown origin, means mesothelioma or primary peritoneal carcinomatosis, stomach, pancreas. In females, if you remove ovary, you look at it, the colon is the main thing in that. So ovary occupies major. If you run a HIPEC program, 50-60% of your HIPECs are ovarian cancer, then colon, then stomach, rectal, pancreas, diverse and other area. So you can see all the journals are there, you know, gynae onco journal, colorectal, pancreas, European journal. So these are the places which are all the origin of HIPEC. Now this is a data of ours from almost last 300-400 peritoneal surface malignancy HIPEC we have done out of 1600 cytoreductive surgeries, my group. Commonest in 68% is ovary for us, then colorectal, mesothelioma, gastric, and PNP. So roughly you must know this is where it sits. Now what is the survival? It's a very important slide to understand. This is extremely, if you leave the ovary where highest survival benefit is there, ovary, leave that. The second best survival with the surgery in peritoneal surface is pseudomyxomas. Routinely, if you don't treat, they leave 5, if you treat, they leave 10 to 15 years. Second thing, you look at this one, mesothelioma. Mesothelioma is second best. Then actually we have a colon, then colorectal, then we have gastric last. So if you understand this, then you know the effort you must put. If you leave ovary, this is it, because ovary is where it has got the highest rewarding thing for the surgeon. So now you can see that the current starts from pelvis, goes here and stops at the, you know, superior coronary ligament at the junction of triangular ligament and the falciform. That's why right diaphragm metastasis is most common for us. Now, normally there are three modality for peritoneal surface malignancy. Modality one, surgery alone, disaster, all 100% recurs. Surgery with IV chemo, 70% recur. Surgery with some form of IV intraperitoneal chemo, then we are looking at 40 to 50%. It is very important to understand in oncology, the expertise available, your training, where you practice, your team, and the place and the type of patient directly relation to your outcome. What is resectable, what is operable is two different issues. Remember, there are two important terms I'll teach you for students. Operable, resectable are different terminology. And technique and awareness of complication, anatomy, need training outside pelvis. What you do in pelvis will not decide the outcome. What you do in the upper abdomen decides the outcome. This is a very important thing. just because you have a hammer, everything is not a nail. In oncology, what can be done is different than what should be done. There may be many things you can be able to do, but remember that is not what should be done. So this whole presentation is to underline these 2 points and I'm going to tell you. So the triad is good skill managing every aspect, nook and corner of abdomen, knowledge of peritoneal surface malignancy, gynecological oncology, GI, urogenital, everything, understanding the DC, and then the training you have the type. It's a triad, which is very important. This is the, I've authored a most important article for FIGO. FIGO approached me to write a chapter on what should be a essential skill set a gynec onco should be there. These are the slides and charts I have put it. You can go and read that FIGO cancer report I've made. What is the minimum training a gynec onco should have? You can go back and read that. These are the slides I put it in that my thought process, which are there. Technique and skill expertise, performance status of the patient, morbidity you can achieve, biology. So remember, all should fall in place for you to achieve optimal cytoreduction. Otherwise, you cannot achieve. This is a very important slide to understand. I'll give you one example. In ovarian cancer, even if you do a good surgery and give IV chemo, stage 3C, which is common, only 10% are alive at 5 years. 90 are dead, even if you do good surgery. This shows that you need something more. This is the true reality anywhere in the world. 100 people you operate, 90 dead at 5 years. So most of the patients come with extensive disease. And remember, cytoreductive surgery means removing all the visible microscopic disease. Ever since Griffith showed that if you remove all the disease, even if you don't give chemo, already 39, 40 months survival, the moment you leave a nodule of more than 1 centimeter, survival drops down to 11 months. Nowhere in oncology you are responsible to go to straight, you know, hell for wrong things we do. Wrong surgery, movie theater to be gone, you're very busy, you want to go, you want to take your girlfriend, family for a dinner, so you do inappropriate surgery, leave 1.5 centimeter. No, God can also cure, no antibody therapy, no immunotherapy will cure. Straight survival, less than 1 year. This is also proved by what is the importance of cytoreductive surgery. No visible macroscopic disease, optimal 5 year survival, 76 months, 55%. Optimal cytoreduction, but around 1 centimeter, 32 months, 32%. If you leave more than 1 centimeter, 5 year survival, 0%, median survival, 1.5 years. Very important to understand this. So the proper definition is not leaving something, no macroscopic disease. This is the new definition that is optimal. If you can't do this, you should not be able to operate the surgery. So you must learn very good surgery in the upper abdomen. What are all the components that comes in cytoreduction? Good peritonectomy, diaphragm disease management, mesentery disease management, small bowel resections, rectosigmoid resection is very common, 76% of the time, pontohepatic management, and then management of the subcrural area, para-aortic nodal disease management. You must learn all these steps, including splenectomy, distal pancreatectomy. This is a paper from our group. All our group has authored it. When we analyzed our over 1,500 procedures, you can see omentum 70%, diaphragm 60%, and then, you know, large bowel 44%, and then pouch of Douglasectomy 45%, omental bursectomy 14%, gastrectomy 4%, splenectomy 7%, gallbladder removal, which means you must learn all these to master. This is what is called. What is this concept? The disease spread predominantly by lymphatic or hematogenous, and it is in the abdominal cavity, not outside. That's why natural history is predominantly in the peritoneum. Remember, there are many factors which predict the outcome. None of them are in our hand. Young age, good performance, we go, none of them are there. Who want to die young? Who want to have cancer? Who want to have a high grade? None of them are there in our hand. Modifiable, non-modifiable, but only two things. Optimal cytoreduction, aggressive surgical mind process. And you know, they always say surgeons should have a delicacy of a lady's finger, eagle's eye, lion's heart, and very, very tender, you know, and compassion. So optimal cytoreduction, good surgical is all we have, and they're modifiable, that decides your patient lives or not. When you see a disease volume like this, never say, oh, this is a day, I'm done, I'll go and have an early coffee, it cannot be resected. Peritoneal surface malignancy, respect surface. Rarely they are infiltrative deep, but even if they are there, one or two visible section, you can remove all the disease. When you see like this, me, I tell my colleagues, you know, Dr. Rohit, Dr. Ashwin, and all my residents, Dr. Ramya Priya, this is the garden party. Today we are going for a feast. This is a buffet in a 7-star hotel. Today, you can work for 7 hours on this, remove all the disease. All of them will be cytoreducible. You may actually have a disease like this. If you look at this, none of them is operable. Everywhere disease started, cancer. Spend another 5-6 hours, the same patient, all peritoneum removed, diaphragm stripped, all disease removed, total supracolicomentectomy, bursectomy, mesenteric stripping, Gleason capsule of liver removed, no disease in this patient. This patient has got very high chance of cure. Now if you do HIPEC, there is a survival. And most of the time, if the patient performance is good, you can always get rid of. There is nothing called inoperable in the abdominal peritoneal surface malignancy. Only limiting factor is performance status of the patient, your surgical expertise, and the place where you practice. There is nothing called inoperable. Everything can be removed. Limiting factor is performance status, your skill, type of patient, and the support system where you are practicing. You can remove everything there. Why should we do all these things? Primary cytoreduction is far superior for surgery after chemo. No study has ever proved surgery after chemo is superior. Never. And remember, for every 10% of extra effort you put, 5.5% extra life you give. Where you have such an effort in the world for you to do? I will show you 1,300 cytoreduction from 2001 to 2018. When I've audited over last 20 years, I'll give you a message from that. Now, this is a very important group. Aggressive surgical team where they operate, the residual disease in them is very low. They add 3.45 years extra. Leg surgeon, they leave a lot of residual disease. They lose 2 years. So greatly influenced by the surgical team you do. So what is the concept of this whole surgery? Four concept. Macroscopic disease seen to high, removed by peritonectomy and multivisceral resection. Still, I told you the cancer cells are there all over the abdomen. If you leave close and come back within 1 year, all will recur. Then you add chemo into the peritoneal cavity, either with heat, without heat, with catheter, without catheter, or after surgery or during surgery. This is what is the concept of whole cytoreductive surgery for us to do this. Is there an evidence? Now look at this particular. There are 7 randomized trials in IP chemotherapy. Except one trial, all of them have shown survival benefit by adding chemo into the abdominal cavity because chemo in the vein will not penetrate. This is something very important to understand that there is a role. Why? When you give IV chemo, peritoneal fluid concentration is very low. It cannot seal cell. The same chemo given into the peritoneal cavity, IV plasma concentration is still adequate, but IP is tenfold, so it can kill the cancer cell. And the penetration of the chemo cancer cell in the peritoneum is less than 5 millimeter if you give IV, but if you put into the peritoneal cavity, it is 10 millimeter. With heat, it is 20 millimeter. Heat and pressure, pneumo and IP, it is more than 3 centimeter. So cisplatin and then pacli are all the most important drug where 1:1,000 concentration is there. You give chemo through IV, it goes into the central core. Cancer cell outside the abdominal cavity will not be affected. You add chemo into that. Then there is an onion peeling skin effect. This chemo with HIPEC or intraperitoneal chemo strips the peritoneal cancer by layer by layer by layer by layer like a butter, and it penetrates up to 1 centimeter, 2 centimeter, 3 based on heat or no heat, pressure or not pressure. So is there an evidence? So you can see that only surgery with chemo, 18 months survival, 50 months overall survival and PFS. But if you add chemo into the abdominal cavity, 66 months and 24 months. That's why there is a lot of evidence which ASCO brought and told, if you can introduce intraperitoneal form of chemo, you should do that. There is an evidence from India. It is from our group. We did a study for 7 years with 5-year, 3 months median follow-up of a 260 patient, 62 months survival by adding chemo into that. Then this is published in European Journal of Cancer. Now I'll tell you what is the concept of peritoneal surface malignancy with last 330 HIPECs we have done. This is most of the patients who are referred to us or any program is, diagnosis is very tough. They would have taken AKT as a TB. People would have done cytology, not got a report, or somebody would have done laparoscopy or a laparotomy, closed, inoperable. So we have this PSS score, biopsy only. They have just done 1 reason, 2 reason. So the best thing is if you can send a patient to a center where it is trying to do, a lot of cancer center where they can do. You can see that in our group, total parietal peritonectomy we do most of the time and a lot of other diseases which need to be stripped. This is the CC score. Now I'll tell you how is it to analyze. Remember, the best way to analyze a peritoneal disease is never CT. The only imaging good is a contrast MRI. However, it is only 75% accurate. Staging laparoscopy is the best technique to analyze the peritoneal volume of the disease. Second best is MRI contrast. All other are inferior. You can see that even if you have a disease on the diaphragm, it is all stripped here, central tendon and inferior phrenic, then you can strip the entire liver capsule, Gleason capsule. You can remove it by single swab technique, double swab technique, finger fracture technique. So the disease can be removed. This is something very important to understand. So second thing is the whole capsule of the liver can be removed. So if you do diaphragm stripping, resection, Gleason capsulectomy, all disease can be removed. This is a study from Mayo Clinic where people do good diaphragm surgery, perform, not perform, see the Kaplan-Meier survival, inferior if you can't remove this disease. Second thing is this is a pelvis. We know that in pelvis we have lot of disease. Organs which are intraperitoneal, preperitoneal, retroperitoneal. So you have gonadal vessels, ureter, colon, intraperitoneal becomes rectosigmoid, retroperitoneal, bladder, preperitoneal. So this is called pouch of Douglas. All of them should be removed like this. Don't do piecemeal surgery. The commonest site of recurrence in gynec malignancy is pouch of Douglas, vaginal vault, rectum, then it is in right diaphragm, and then omental bursa and proximal mesentery. So these are the stress points. So don't do piecemeal surgery after chemo. Remove the entire bladder peritoneum, pouch of Douglasectomy, retrograde hysterectomy, pelvic peritonectomy. Then the whole thing will come out like this. And what we normally do is we clamp the bladder. Bladder is distended preperitoneally with a ballpoint cautery with 100 spray mode. I remove the entire bladder peritoneum. Then you go down with that until you go into the rectum. Then you do a pouch of Douglasectomy. See this? And then retrograde hysterectomy. Then rectosigmoid resection. No colostomy required. Less than 2% in peritoneal surface malignancy need colostomy. Anterior colpotomy, posterior colpotomy, then hysterectomy. See, everything in the pelvis is removed. Nothing called inoperable there. So this is what is a important technique for us to understand how we can go ahead and do this. If you have a disease on a small bowel mesentery, there are five ways you can do it. You can take a fine tip ball contrary. Then you have a 100 spray mode. It works like a laser, electro clearance you can do. Fine tip cautery, 100 spray mode, entire mesentery can be removed. And there is another way you can remove this. This video is Dr. Ashwin, my colleague, his finger. Inject the air with a varis needle. Put your finger, strip the entire mesentery. Peritoneal surface malignancy respects surface. Remove the entire mesentery. Then take a scissor and cut on the both sides, the whole disease is out. Second technique this is. Third technique is when you have disease like this, don't think, oh, time is out, I'm going to go inoperable. Take a ballpoint cautery, 100 spray mode, saline to be put, and then entire, if you spend time, or you can use a CUSA. This is an equipment which has got an ultrasound, suction, water jet, and monopolar. All working together, you can remove. And in 45 minutes, all disease can be removed. I told you there's nothing called inoperable. Or I always use this argon laser. You can see that this is an argon plasma coagulator. It has got a depth of penetration not more than 7 to 10 millimeter. You can use it on the intestine, on the bladder, on the ureter without injuring. Use all of them, whole strip. I strip the mesentery. And then I use this laser. You can see that 5 minutes, bloodless, I remove it. This is a very useful armamentarium. Always it is there when we operate and a very important step for us to do. Now look at all this effort of cytoreduction. Good surgery, no good surgery. Upper abdomen aggressive surgery not done. Survival 43 months. Good surgery done 54 months. This is a survival. Just your surgery is giving extra 3 years, 3.45, about 4 months. So this is what is very important. So now where does we sit with this HIPEC then? Is surgery cytoreduction alone? No. Majority will recur if you cannot do this. So the concept of HIPEC came. What is HIPEC? In 1980s, Pratt first described this, later popularized by Sugarbaker and other group and Netherlands Cancer Institution. In 2004, Madrid International Peritoneal Surface Malignancy coined this term, and then this thing started. How did the evidence come? The early Italian group found that a aggressive surgery alone, survival was here, if you had heat and then chemo into the abdominal cavity, this is the survival. They found a lot of meta-analysis, which they found median survival and progression changes significantly if you can add heated chemotherapy to the abdominal cavity. There are a lot of randomized trials. I'll not go into pros and cons because I don't want to stick to very high basics. My aim, the aim of any of such talks by Cancer Academy is to stimulate you, show the direction, take you to water, not to spoon feed you. I will just give a, I will stimulate your brain, give ideas, you go back and expand on it and read. There are a lot of trials which started showing probably heat is doing something, chemo into the peritoneal doing anything. So how did it go then? We will see this. Heat per se kills malignant cells at 41 degree and above. So heat itself inhibits RNA, DNA, protein synthesis, arrests the cell and induces apoptosis, and then increase lysosomal activation and glycolysis. These are the path by which heat acts. Way back 1977, most of are not born who are listening, except my senior colleagues. Then they found heat has all this effect. Then they found that heat with chemo has a synergistic. What is synergistic? 1 + 1 = 2. 1 + 1 becomes 3 or 5. That is called synergistic. Potentiating action. You know that if you drink alcohol, you are going to die with problem. You smoke, you die. But if you do both, the timeline is not 1 + 1. It is 1 + 1 = 3. So that is called a synergistic effect. So heat also increases the act. This is known very well. We all know that if you raise your body temperature by 1 degree, all the enzymes and hormones work well. That's why in fever, we have 1 degree rise in temperature. So synergistic effect of our immune system kills. So heat increases the efficiency of the chemo. We already know chemo into the abdominal cavity penetrates more and kills. Heat alone kills. Heat will aid more killing. But the New York Times published an article when Annals of, this is an Annals of Surgery, which told we should use heat to kill cancer. Then they wrote, inhuman people, you remember how people crucified when somebody told earth is not flat but round, they murdered him. When people told wash your hand, please, microorganisms are there, they banished and they become mad. So New York Times, you know, made fun of the Annals of Surgery journal, which published heat is on for cancer. They told heat is on. These people who are butchers, who are killing people, should be hanged. They wrote here, shame on the medical community, way back 1970. New York Times ran, you can't do HIPEC. Then came the randomized control trial in 2003, which showed HIPEC has a survival benefit by our close friend Vic Verwal. Then a lot of randomized trial keep on coming, then medicine changed. So macroscopic disease is removed by cytoreductive surgery and, you know, peritonectomy. Chemo, 1 to 2 millimeter, heat furthermore. Now, why, what heat is right heat? Phase 1, phase 2 lab, they found that if you give IV chemo, in peritoneal cavity, hardly any concentration. The same chemo in the peritoneal cavity kills cancer cell, high concentration in the peritoneum, also in the blood. This is first research. Second research is, what is the right heat? Room temperature and chemo, less effect. Heat with chemo, they found, see the survival here. So this trial told, oh, there is something happening. Now, what heat? They started off from 39 degree, went up to 46 degree. They found once you cross 43 degree, perforation, bladder damage, complication, death is high. But the therapeutic window is 41 to 42 degree. Ideally 39 degree effect starts. Once you cross 42.5, complication happens. So this is the third trial. So now all of them are combined. Heat, intraperitoneal, ideal temperature, that is the activity. Now next, why don't we give IV chemo during HIPEC? So it sensitizes, this is called a bidirectional therapy, very popular in colorectal and gastric cancers. So the synergistic effect starts at 39 degree, it worsens and loses at 43 degree. You cross 43 degree, chemo gets deactivated and harmful perforation complication is high. So various research finally told temperature is 39 to 43, 49.5 is the most common temperature. Above 43, you should not add. Chemo, temperature, now the time. It is not that you just put for 2 minutes and come out. 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 90 minutes. It is found 90 minutes is better. Beyond 90 minutes, there is no benefit. Below 30 minutes, no use. So see how much we achieved at this. HIPEC machine should control temperature at 41.5. Perfusion rate should be right. Reservoir volume of fluid should be right. Pressure should be right. So there are a lot of US FDA approved. Don't do with desi heart-lung machine. You will do more damage to the people. You will end up with medical legal problem. In court of law, you can't defend. Use a good commercially available machine because it is not just mean temperature maintained. No hot spot, no cold spot. Also important is that heat is maintained equally in all the parts with the right perfusion pressure. 90 minutes. What is the right perfusion pressure and flow rate? Minimum 900 ml per minute flow should be there. Usually we use 1 to 1.5. Less than 900 ml per minute perfusion is not adequate to cure or get rid of cancer. That's why we put these machines and we do a touch screen and then we analyze. This is a semi-open. See, we have put a smoke evacuator. Abdomen is converted into Roman Colossian system and then you do a HIPEC. Now, what is the advantage? There are two techniques. Closing the tummy and doing opening, closed and open. Pros and cons. If you open, a lot of heat is lost. So a lot of time is required to do. But you can see where it is hot. You can rinse the temperature. You can, if there is a hot spot, you can change the catheters. You can change the diodes. If it is a cold spot, you can move the heat there. So advantage, disadvantage are there both of closed and open. Closed technique, you do HIPEC. If something happens in the abdomen, you can't do anything because hot spot is there. In open, you can do, but close very fast, you can achieve temperature. Priming is fast, lesser temperature. 30 to 60 minutes closed is equivalent to 90 minutes of open. But these are all the advantage, disadvantage. This presentation will be on the YouTube. I'll not waste your time going through what. This is just to stimulate. There are pros of open. There are cons of closed also. Both have one to do pickup. Both institute can be done. So there was a, see in our paper which we published, we found worldwide 19 countries equal. 58% people do open, 42% close, which means you are not wrong. Do what is right in your center, what you have learned properly. So these are all the combination. Finally, this was put into an end. When there are two things, to do, not to do, people keep fighting because people love fighting. What we can't do doesn't exist in the world. Because I can't do that, that doesn't exist, that is wrong. That's wrong. So there was a consensus meeting in Milan to sort out this issue, closed or open. Then they came with all the evidence in December 4 to 6, 2006, Milan. They told neither one of them is superior to each. Both are equal to do. This is an open technique called Colossium. See how we use, you know, you, these are medicated rubber bands available. You know, we use this in our airplane to put the luggage. So you, they're medicated, you sterilize them, use a clip applicator, and then you make a Colossium. Then you use a special smoke evacuator. This is called a tent. This is commercially available. So you put this tent, connect the smoke evacuator, the whole thing is available here. So open technique advantage, closed technique advantage. Then you wear a double gloves, you protect yourself so nobody is at injury in the OT. Now there are two important terminology you must know if you do HIPEC peritoneal surface malignancy. One is called a CC score. Don't say optimal site reduction 1 centimeter. It's crude to use that term. Use CC score, completeness of cytoreductive score. CC 0, no cancer seen when I'm closing the abdomen. CC 1, less than 2.5 millimeter, granular disease at a vital area of bowel, still HIPEC helps. More than 2.5 millimeter, HIPEC doesn't help. Anything more than 1 centimeter you do, it is a crime to do it. You may get away now, but when you go to hell, God will not allow you to get away. Second thing, PCI index. There has to be a common language. You can say very bad disease, a lot of cancer, no meaning. You have to reproduce it. Why do we have HSCC TNM classification? A person sitting in Bangalore or a person sitting in Delhi or a person sitting in, you know, Milan, US, when he says this TNM or this FIGO stage or this stage, everybody must understand what I am looking at. So standardize the technique and people understand. Research, study, knowledge, discussion can be there. So PCI index is peritoneal cancer index based on the, it is divided into 9, 0 to 1 to 3, and then the lesion size of 0.5, 5, and more than 5. So based on this, you have a score, you can achieve 36, 39 high PCI index. These are the randomized trial in each. Remember, HIPEC at this moment, other than ovary, is not a high level 1 evidence. In ovary, it has come very close, and in colorectal mid-segment, it has come, and I'll tell you where is it. So in ovary, we have these two trials. upfront, you know, interval setting, OV hypec, recurrent in spillouts. Colorectal, we have Vic Verals, Prodig 7, Profilochip for prophylactic. In ovary, it has not yet come. Gastric, Cytochip, Gastrochip. Pseudomyxoma, no randomized control trial, so level of evidence is 2B and below, only registries. Peritoneal mesothelioma, only case meta-analysis available, but no RCT. So it is very important to understand before you go. What can be done is different than what should be done. Operability is different than resectability. So this is the most important trial called as Van Driel's trial, which showed HIPEC as a benefit in interval CA ovary. Van Driel trial, multicentric, multi-institutional across the Netherlands and some Dutch and then, you know, Danish. Van Driel trial is for interval cytoreduction in ovarian cancer, randomized trial. It showed there is both PFS and overall survival benefit. Now OV HIPEC 2 trial in a upfront surgery is going on, but in our hospital, when we looked at 150 patients, we found the best result that is derived is a patient in a upfront than interval. When you operate first without chemo and then do HIPEC, had a best survival in our group, and that paper Dr. Ramya and Rohit and our team is uploading just now. That's a trial. So you can see our trial versus all. This is what survival showed. By doing all this, now you also must be thinking like New York Times, is patient alive? Yes, up kar the operation successful, patient died. Is it so? Are we damaging the patient? Student must be terrorized. Such thing happened to patients. So they analyzed quality of life and complication. This was presented in S1 published, which showed quality of life after 21 days doesn't change or bad because of doing HIPEC. No extra morbidity mortality. So in a learning curve past 100, at least HIPEC done center, learning curve in HIPEC is 100. The morbidity mortality is almost same as that of a cytoreductive. Quality of life after 3 weeks is same. So that is a proof of pudding. Lot of trials have summarized. Even in our hospital, we have found in spite of doing such complicated, stoma rate is not more than 2.6%. And then the leak rate is less than 4%. So these are the trials which have come, you can know. Second thing you must know while operating is there are anesthesia management very important. And there are three phases. During surgery, abdomen is open, patient becomes cold, AC is 80 degrees centigrade, 5 hours operation. That is called as phase of hypothermia. Phase of hypothermia, see, this is the curve given by Dr. Murthy, Dr. Jalja, my anesthetist, who mapped out all our patients' temperature curve. During surgery, because of exposure, third phase loss, sequestration, temperature falls down. Complication of hypothermia happens, which is acidosis, other things. Once you start HIPEC, core temperature goes to 39, patient goes to a phase of hyperthermia. This is where you have to manage oxygen, fluid, everything. Once you complete this surgery, they cool with IV fluids, which is cold, frozen saliva, or like, you know, low temperature, then phase of normothermia. This is where acidosis, then patient is extubated. Extubation possible after HIPEC is single most prognostic marker for survival and morbidity. You must try to do as much as possible. It doesn't matter, keep in ICU, but extubate. Fluid electrolyte balance, temperature management. So three temperature is available. And this is a warmer we use in Manipal. Patient goes inside this, the same one will warm the patient during surgery, hypothermia. After HIPEC is over, the same machine will cool the patient. So this is a blanket, patient goes inside. Like in you go to Mount Everest, you know, cold, the same thing warms, and the chemo is administered like this. And this is a paper which our group has published. Chemo should be given based on the body surface area per kg or based on the volume of fluid or combining both. So this is a Manipal protocol we have published. It's available. You can go and read. Second thing is the dose of chemo is very, very important. You can see in our survey, 52% based only on body surface area. This is wrong. This is not IV chemo. You should not based on this. You have to look at the volume of the abdominal cavity, male patient, female patient, and then body surface area and the fluid volume used. That is the right way to do. So we have published a paper called a standardization of patient selection and protocol for chemo. You can go back and read this. It will show very well. So you have a disease like this and the whole thing is removed with a ballpoint cautery with the extra abdominal peritoneal cavity. Then you put this catheter with a diode, temperature diode, 6 to 7 thermocouples all over the abdomen. Then make a colosseum abdominal cavity. See, this blue thing are thermocouples. Real time will tell the temperature in all the sectors of abdomen. We achieve temperature. Then we put this offside, make a semi-open technique. And I fondly, you know, call this particular, this is a pump which uses HIPEC. Then once you prime means target temperature of 41 degree, then you add the chemo, wear big long gloves here. And now I fondly call this, you know, this is called as frying of Chinese noodles. So you take actually a wooden spoon and then you actually bake the intestines with heat. This is the high tech. So this is how it is done. Looks easy, but you know, very important to understand. What is the morbidity? 12% of them have grade 3 toxicity. 60-day hospital mortality is 2.5. This is only if you have passed 100. Many people have 4% mortality, 30 to 40% complication in the learning curve. That's why it's very important to pass the learning curve. This is not something which is easy. This is our data. Anastomotic leak 1.84% in spite of surgery and HIPEC. That's why we stopped doing any stoma. This is very, very important to understand. These are the common chemo, ovary cisplatin, colon oxaliplatin, and then you can use mitomycin for pseudomyxoma gastric and doxorubicin also for recurrent ovary. So this is, the toxicity is based on the chemo you use. I'll not bore you. This is a data which Dr. Ramya, my one of a profound intelligent student, published. This paper is available, toxicity profile of chemo in cytoreduction from Indian Center. You can see Dr. Ramya and Dr. Ashwin and my team who has worked this in European journal. Please go back and read only paper in the history of IPEC, chemo-wise published. Credit goes to Dr. Ramya and Dr. Rohit and Ashwin. So the complications are like this. Cisplatin causes renal problem, electrolyte. Other chemo causes hematological problem. Oxaliplatin causes bleeding tendencies. Whenever you give chemo onto HIPEC, there is a score called as PRGS score. One of my favorite resident doctor, you know, Priya, is working on this PRGS. If you give chemo, when you open, it looks everything is gone and you think I'll remove the uterus, take a momentum is gone. No, there is something called as peritoneal regression score. No tumor, tumor present not. It is found that 75% of the time, even though for visible eye, abdomen looks normal, peritoneal looks normal, there is a cancer. So the concept of going and doing peritonectomy. This is a work of Dr. Rohit. Should anastomosis be done before starting the HIPEC or after? Before heat, after heat. Because the advantage is if you do before healthy bowel, very easy. After, if you do, you can look at the effect of heat, but difficult to do. This was published in, presented in ASCO GI by me on behalf of Dr. Rohit and our team. He found that all the HIPEC, stomach, small bowel, large bowel, stoma, very large volume study, you know, 214 patients, no different before you do or after. This is our paper. And Dr. Rohit is just uploaded to a journal and the credit goes to him. So in HIPEC, you do before or after, doesn't matter. I have last 14 minutes to end this presentation. I will touch upon a little bit of morbidity. Normally 4% mortality in learning curve, 34% grade 3 toxicity. But remember, this grade 3 toxicity looks 34. You go and audit your normal surgery. What is, you know, if you have a fluid collection, you need to drain it, parasympathetic ultrasound guided. Or if there is a pleural fluid post-surgery, you have to drain it. That is a grade 3 toxicity. So don't get carried away seeing 34% complication. You do your cytoreduction and audit properly, you will have the same complication. Complications doesn't lead to death. Most of them are normal and treatable. Now most of the center will have less than 3% morbidity. In our analysis bivariate, we found high volume of disease, PCI, duration of surgery, which is long, blood loss high, has an impact on that. Blood loss of, you know, ROC curve, this was given by Dr. Ramya, 800 ml blood loss predicts more morbidity. Duration of surgery touching 10 hours predicts morbidity. PCI, high volume more than 20 predicts morbidity. But performance status is the only contraindication. Nothing is inoperable except performance status. So in multivariate analysis, this paper is going to go, Ramya and, you know, Dr. Rohit are working eagerly. And we published complication of hyperthermia. Dr. Prasanna, my resident, published it way back. You can, you know, see back very, very, very early in almost 2007, he published it. Second thing very important to understand is when you do such major surgery, patients go very late for chemo. If you delay the chemo, survival is affected. What we found is if you don't do HIPEC, this delay will it affect survival and defeat. So this is a study which we did, impact of delay. What is interesting we found is if you do HIPEC that acts like one chemo, then the delay beyond 45 days of chemo didn't impact. So this acts like a chemo, but if you don't do HIPEC and by chance some complication happens, patient is not eating well, chemo is delayed, survival is affected. So this paper is published in Pleura and Peritoneum by our group. Dr. Ramya published it just recently. It's her hard work with support to Rohit and Ashwin. And you can read that delay didn't impact if you do HIPEC, but this delay impacts if you don't do HIPEC. You can go back and read. Second group is, we compared surgery alone, surgery with normal, without heat chemo and heat. And we found that the survival was best when you add HIPEC. So HIPEC, any form of intraperitoneal chemo gives benefit. If you just do surgery, survival benefit was inferior. This is something I recommend all the new beginners, called as Aletti score. There is another score called as Fegatti score, which means just because you can operate, what can be done is not what should be done. Based on the type of procedure required to achieve no cancer, there is a low risk, intermediate, high, and you can validate this. If it is high, even though you can operate, they may die and they may not derive a benefit. You need to look at it. Now, there was a question asked in the quiz. What is the volume of peritoneum? Should it be full or not? We did this study. This got a best award, poster award in Paris by our group. Total peritoneum means what I will tell you. If you remove total peritoneum, even though it looks normal for eye, but you remove infield, you know, we open the sheath, we don't open the abdominal cavity. The peritoneum is there like a sac. You go ahead there and then the hole, see that is a sac. In that sac, whole abdominal quantity is there. We have not opened the abdomen. Whole peritoneum is stripped up to the aorta, vena cava, into the bladder, into the diaphragm. And then you do this particular surgery. And then, you know, this is a single swap technique, double swap technique, or Cautery technique. Then we found if you remove entire peritoneum, recurrence in abdomen is 35%. You don't remove entire peritoneum, then it is 52%. Survival was affected very significantly. And this is a paper. If you remove peritoneal, parietal peritonectomy, peritoneal recurrence were low. And so this paper actually was extensively worked by Ashwin, Ramya, and then Rohit and our team. And they published it, impact of peritonectomy. There are three papers that group published, our fellow. This was worked out by Ramya and Rohit, and they found it as a benefit. This is a second paper Rohit published in ovarian cancer alone, which showed in ovary cancer, parietal peritonectomy has survival benefit. This is a paper which was done by Ashwin and Rohit in colorectal, published in IJC. All three showed extent of parietal peritonectomy is good. But for the student, the right answer is mesothelioma, pseudomyxoma, primary peritoneal carcinoma, you should mandatory do total parietal peritonectomy. In all other place, it is not level one evidence. So you do infield. So it is based on the extent of histopathology. Mesothelioma, pseudomyxoma, primary peritoneal, or ovary post chemo you do. In rest, currently people do infield resection. And this is a paper which is available everywhere. You can go back and read, and we compared this and did it. And these are also available in JCO. So what did we find? I'll take one example. With HIPEC, we had a 74 months in primary. In platinum sensitive, very poor, recurrent 32 months, and 18 months in platinum resistant. So this is what an impact we had in our institution. So this was honored that one full day ASCO and Medscape discussed all our institute group for a whole day. And this was honor for India, where they discussed whole day exclusively on only paper from India. And they gave a credit to our work. And this is also published in this. You can go back and read this. Now I will finish in next 5 minutes telling what is the role in each. In ovary, I told you already. As of now, intravel chemo is the high level evidence. Trials are going for upfront, we have to wait. Recurrent, there is a RCT, not fully accepted, but there is an RCT. Colorectal, gastric, I'll give you two examples. So this is the evidence. Upfront in ovary, intravel, consolidation, recurrence. So I have written level one, level two, level three, and the evidence for that. This is very good, this is for advanced people. Based on all the paper I've analyzed, this is how you can put it. In colorectal, recent new trial called PRODIC 7 showed HIPEC will not benefit in colorectal if you have a high volume of disease. Less than level, HIPEC doesn't help, surgery is enough. Above 15 PCI, high volume, HIPEC will not help. So in colorectal, this trial showed only between 11 to 15 group you should do HIPEC. This is a very good randomized controlled trial. Colorectal, non-signet histology, 11 to 15 only will help. Less than that, not required. Above 15 will not help. Remember this. This is something which is very important to understand. Then it helps. Surgery alone, 42 months. If you do high peak in 11 to 15, only then it helps. Otherwise, no. Profilo chip is a negative trial. If you open a colorectal, you see a disease with perforation on the surface. Prophylactically, if you do high peak, does it help? No. The answer is no. Colopec also showed high risk colon prophylactic. No, it didn't show. So, four trials in colon, only group it helps is 11 to 16. Pseudomyxoma peritonei, I told you, no randomized trial. So it is a level 2B, not high level evidence, level 2B. But it showed if you do surgery and high peak, survival of 10 year lifespan is 74%. With surgery alone, without hyper, 33 months. This is a very good paper. Please go and read from JCO in pseudomyxoma. Appendix, low grade pseudomyxoma, this is the benefit. In gastric cancer, last 1 year, four trials came, randomized control trial. This is a randomized phase 3 trial, which is published very well, which showed in stomach with a low volume PCI. Means only in the upper abdomen of PCI of less than 7, there was a survival benefit. Otherwise, stomach is not a good disease. This is a cytochip study, which is a propensity trial, which is published in May 2019, which showed a benefit of HIPEC in gastric cancer, but a low PCI. There are three other trials which are going now called as GastriChip, and then another GastriPEC and Periscope. We are waiting for the result. It is exciting to do in stomach, but remember, after chemo, sensitive, low volume disease, it is useful in stomach. So this is an ongoing, you do a laparoscopy. Remember, laparoscopy best to assess PCI. Next is MRI contrast. All other are inferior. This is a trial. In mesothelioma, mesothelioma is a disease which most of the time come late, asbestosis, chemical injury, miliary disease, no major organ involvement, but it is there. Only 2 points. Ki-67 is called as MIB index. This shows proliferation. Low Ki-67, then mesothelioma HIPEC has very good cure rate. High Ki-67 doesn't help. And low PCI, Ki-67 doesn't matter, you can operate. So two parameters in mesothelioma, Ki-67 and PCI. So this is a very good paper. You can go back and read from Shigeki, our friend from Milan group, which showed that you have to look at lymph node involvement or not, PCI, Ki-67, then you can do. I told you, next to pseudomyxoma, best survival of HIPEC is in mesothelioma if you leave the ovary. So what is the answer? More than 9% Ki-67, more than 17 patient unlikely to benefit. This is the answer. Now the last two slide is, if you actually put pressure, this is called PIPAC, intraperitoneal chemo through a specialized aerosol. This is making chemo into aerosol and pneumoperitoneum of laparoscopy pressure. See, chemo without heat, penetration 10 millimeter. Chemo with heat, 15 to 20 millimeter. With pressure, pressurized intraperitoneal chemo, more than 2.5 centimeters. So this is very exciting new thing. You can go back and read. This is not a preview of my talk. We also add a generator and we add an electrical charge of this chemo drugs and go. It is called as electric PIPAC. So these are very exciting. This is a paper actually, you know, our group really published, and this credit goes to Dr. Ashwin. He put it up, this paper, and also in South Asian cancer, you can go back and read in Indian group of patients for peritoneal surface malignancy, how it helped, and two randomized trial undergoing, which Dr. Priya, who is, you know, foreseeing, it's a part of our dissertation, we published in pleural peritoneum. So in conclusion, I want to explain, this is the real life scenario of my experience from 2001 to 2011. Surgery alone, advanced surgery, IP chemo without heat and then with heat. Initially, our mortality was less than 1. When we did high peak in the learning curve, we went very close to 3.5 to 4, then we stabilized. Mortality, see that mortality, 4%. It has now dropped down to around 1.5% in our group after doing more than 350, 400. Optimal cytoreduction in our hospital. In my surgery, I have all the gadgets. We work as a team. Dr. Ashwin Rohit would start with Dr. Vijay Ahuja, sir. Then second group come, third group. So there is no fatigue. Three group surgical team with all laser, everything, working relentlessly on the patient. We have 91% optimal cytoreduction in our institution currently. And then you can see that with surgery, we had 32 months. Advanced surgery, 42 months. With IP 60, now we have crossed more than 70 and reaching 100 survival. So in every success story, it is you have to take a correct decision and then take. But remember, a fool with a good tool is still a fool. Don't think that a bad surgery is going to be compensated by a high peg. So cytoreductive surgery is the cornerstone. If you can't do a good cytoreductive surgery with low morbidity and low mortality, then no use doing any of high peg. And operating team is very important. 50 to 100 learning curve, good dedicated machine, and a good team. And remember, MRI is best, above that is laparoscopy. Tumor marker should be done. Staging laparoscopy is very important. Dosage is based on BSA per liter per kg. Perioperative anesthesia management is very important. These are the main drugs, working horse for high peg intraperitoneal. Closed open doesn't matter. 41.5 degrees optimal, above 43 you injure. Colorectal only 11 to 15. Ovary interval level, very high level evidence. Recurrent level 2B, upfront trials are going. Stomach, no high level evidence, but one RCT in low. Mesothelioma, very good. In low Ki-67 PCI. Approval from DGCA should be taken in India with IRB to do at this moment, dedicated machine. Remember, good cytoreduction is cornerstone. Bad cytoreduction will not be compensated by good high peg. Good high peg will not compensate for a bad CRS. So what is our thing? Primum non orsi, that is no harm first. Audit your morbidity and mortality, publish, discuss, then pay attention to patient selection, OT preparation, teamwork, knowledge, public. If my resident don't publish, every day I'm after our resident, you know, Dr. Priya and everybody, please publish, publish. So they see me, they run away from Patli Gali. So that sir will trouble me to audit and publish. But without audit, we are any other human being with an opinion, which has, in my experience, I did 50. Where is publication? No. I have never seen this thing happening. That is just an opinion, has no value in science. Adequate patient should be selected. Right patient, right team, right this one, and the teamwork of everybody. Remember, all truth was passed through three phase. It will be ridiculed. People laugh at you. You're doing high peg. Then violently they will oppose the moment you know you're getting good result. Then they will call and say, I have my relative, my fee, myself, can you do it? Then they'll say, please teach me. So don't worry. Everybody has gone through this. Even Thomas Alva Edison, everybody. Lessons learned. Recognize mistake. Observe what works. Document it. Share it. Let it be criticized. You improve. So it's a time to understand. This is a Kanchan Gunga, Mount Everest. Surgery alone. Surgery with chemo alone here. And then surgery with IP chemo, surgery with heat. Probably we may see God there if you go there. This is the team, my whole team. Not one person, not I, me, myself. It is a team. You lack any of this team, pain specialist, dietitian, rehabilitation, OT, anesthetist, group of surgeons, then you can't proceed. So it is a time to take the challenge and go. I leave my last slide. None of this is in our hand. Young patient, good performance. Who want to have cancer? Who want to have deployed? What is there in our hand? Optimal cytoreduction, surgery performed by aggressive surgeon in ovary, gynae, onco. So success isn't about the end, but the journey and how you went. So I welcome everybody to please visit this website, be member of Indian Peritoneal Surface Malignancy, download this form, go ahead and do. Remember what you do before you close abdomen, ask a conscious decision yourself. Have I given my best shot? Have I removed all disease? Is there a cure or I'm not curing this patient? That gives a good answer for you. Thank you very much. That is my second lovely daughter who looks like a Rapunzel. I stick to my time. I just ended exactly my 60 minutes. I'm happy to take questions. Thank you.
Amazing, sir. Amazing. It has been really amazing. And I must say there were a lot of life lessons for a surgical oncologist like me, and not just about high peg, but how to conduct surgery in itself. There are some questions here, and I'm sure Sanjeev is just collating all of them for you to answer.
More than happy.
Yeah, Sanjeev, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Yeah.
So there are a few questions which have been asked. So everyone was so much involved and you're patiently listening to the presentations that all the questions came towards the end of the presentation. So a few questions. Do you have any PCI cutoff for ovarian cancer?
Now, you know, it is very important to understand all the peritoneal surface malignancy I showed. The moment you have peritoneal disease, it is stage 4. So the task to start with, they are stage 4, palliative, non-curable. But ovary is the only place where tons and tons of peritoneal disease is still stage 3C. That's why there is no cutoff of PCI, which any study has shown. PCI in ovary is a marker of morbidity and mortality. But if you can achieve optimal cytoreduction, not a marker of prognosticator in the outcome after high-pick. But not so in all others. So in ovary, it is a marker of morbidity and mortality. But PCI cutoff, no. Everybody, PCI, any PCI will benefit with a good surgery and high-pick in that.
Okay. So the next question. So what is your experience about of upfront CRS high-pick in CA ovary as compared to in interval setting?
Okay, that is the area of interest for us. We have analyzed, now this is the paper Dr. Ramya and Rohit has just uploaded to JCGO journal. We found that upfront, the volume of cases are very upfront cytoreduction high-pick had a better survival than interval. So I will be not be surprised OV high-pick 2 trial, which is going on, will show a positive result. So high volume number in our center, upfront surgery high-pick in ovary was superior to interval.
So let me rephrase that question. Which, if all were supposed to be operable, which one would you send for a chemotherapy first rather than taking them up for surgery?
There are two answers. Even if you see URTC, study which was published by Bergot, stage 3A-B patient benefited with upfront surgery and not chemo alone. Now there is a subclassification which has come that surgery after chemo is not superior, which means I'll answer in this way. It is based only on two things: your expertise, your skill level, and then where you practice and the rescue system available and the performance status. If a performance status of the patient is good, your team has an experience to do. Always do upfront surgery and I never send for chemo. The only condition I send for chemo first is low performance status, extra abdominal disease like large volume of pleural effusion malignant, or patient has a nodal disease in the inguinal area and suprachoroidal. Remember, they are not inoperable. Selected patient after cytoreduction is there. So performance status of the patient poor will not withstand, because you can't open abdomen, come back with disease left. It's worst, as good as no surgery. Low performance, expertise available, extra abdominal disease are the only group I send. Otherwise, we operate upfront. In our hospital, 76% to 80% undergo upfront surgery stage 3C. But that is not an issue everywhere. Worldwide, 76% undergo for chemo first, which is not wrong because of the expertise and then the performance status of the patient. As long as you do a good surgery, after that, before should be okay. But please don't send a patient for chemo just for the sake of thinking surgery is going to be easy. No. It is inferior. I found that surgery done upfront with high-pick has better result than interval, because you get into that pseudo veil that you open, everything is clear, thoda nikal loge, it will come back.
Next question. So what is your view about ERAS protocol in CRS high-pick? So how difficult it is?
Okay, I'll tell you one trade secret. There is a NCURE ERAS society, you know that. ERAS society in the world, and we have a high-pick society. High-pick society and ERAS society joined together last year. They picked up 12 experts in the world who have done high volume high-pick and practice ERAS. So I was honored that I was the only guy from Asia to be that. We met in Paris and we met in Marrakesh, which is very close to Casablanca. We just next week in European Journal of Surgical Onco, ERAS for high-pick is going to be published in 2 volumes as a guideline. And it is very important. ERAS easily can be applied in high-pick with little modifications and still shows a very good report. And we are a part of a prospective trial of ERAS. So ERAS 80% can be applied. Just wait for a week. I'll pass on those 2 papers where we formed an expert recommendation, which is going to be practiced worldwide now. But it is feasible, should be practiced. It has a benefit.
So the next question. So many a times we encounter cardiophrenic lymph node in CA ovary. So how to treat these patients? Do we still go ahead with curative intent and offer these patients with?
I'll put a context. This was a very good group from William Hell and Asima group, which showed that when high volume para-aortic nodal burden is there, 21% of the patient have cardiophrenic. For students, I will tell you what is cardiophrenic. Para-aortic lymph node dissection ends at renal vein. Celiac crest of diaphragm, as you go in, right arcuate ligament diaphragm, which takes a right crest, heart and the diaphragm, cardiophrenic. it is an extension of celiac trunk supraparotid. It was 21%. They found that you put a thoracoscopy and remove, and if it is positive, the survival drops down to less than 25%. Don't do it. But I have found in our setup only 16% cardiophrenic are positive. In absence of lung pleural disease, they still do well. If it is associated with pleural metastasis on a pleuroscopy, then they don't do well. So this is the history. I would recommend people to go back and read this paper. So when you have high paraaortic celiac disease, cardiophrenic node can be positive. In absence of supraclavicular, upper mediastinum and pleural disease, they are still resectable. They have survival benefit.
So next question on the extent of peritonectomy. Do you recommend total peritonectomy for all stage 2 and beyond CA ovary?
No. Total parietal peritonectomy should be done mandatory if in interval site reduction, because you have not done a laparoscopy, you have not known the volume of disease. When you go in, all is bland. We think the chemo helps only if it is optimal site reduction of 5 millimeter is before chemo. Interval site reduction, when you are given, when you go, if you remove what is seen to eye, it will come back. That's why worst results by inadequate surgery. So I recommend, as per the evidence, interval site reduction, do parietal peritonectomy. Mesothelioma, primary peritoneal carcinomatosis, pseudomyxoma, you must do. This is a non-controversial evidence-based answer to student. In our institution, based on our study, we recommend total parietal peritonectomy for stage 3C and above, not below that.
Yeah, rightly said, sir. So another question, does the morphology, nodular versus plaque of metastatic deposit, alter the prognosis?
What happened? Both of them fall into a category of PRGS score of 2 and 3. Usually, plaque variety has an infiltrative disease, and then you may have to do little organ ablation. So we tend not to do that, and more blood loss. But a small miliary is easy to remove. But both of them has got 70% chance of trapped microscopic viable cancer cells. So both can be removed. Plaque has more chance of visceral deep penetration and resection. So technically it has more blood loss, more time and more morbidity. So you have to be careful when you do that, balance it.
So another question, what is the intent of surgery if the patient is having pleural effusion or extra abdominal disease like a supraclavicular lymph node in CA ovary?
In CA ovary, any resectable extra abdominal disease still has a survival benefit. I'll give an example. Liver parenchymal 1 or 2 max, if you can achieve optimal site reduction going and doing metastectomy, yes. Isolated supraclavicular after chemo, that's a selected group. It is quite common. If you can remove in absence of mediastinal node, which you are not able to address, still it has got survival benefit. Inguinal node, bulky nodes through, like ground ligament are resectable. So even though supraclavicular, mediastinal node, inguinal node, extra-abdominal is a bad marker, if selected group with good performance status, good response, metastectomy can be added. You should not shy away in a good performance, because those group still have a survival benefit.
So plenty of questions are coming in. So if time permits, should I ask more? Dr. Shubham, is it okay?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Geeta is the, this one, we are, I don't, and this is a topic which never ends. It goes on. I remember I went to Canada and Walter Gottlieb called me for a oration on HIPEC, presidential oration to the society. They made me give oration for 1 hour, 45 minutes nonstop. After that, question went for 1 hour, 18 minutes. 3.5 hours, they didn't leave me. And when British Society of Gynecological Oncology called me to Birmingham to give a presidential address on HIPEC there, they gave me 45 minutes. Britishers, for their own president, don't give more than 15 minutes. 45 minutes oration, 1 hour, 15 minutes question. It doesn't end. So all good things have to come to an end. I told you this is not a spoon feeding. I don't want to take people to water and make them drink. Stimulate their mind. Show the direction. Please read. Otherwise, it is not right. And over to Geeta, and she will have a final call on this.
So what a mesmerizing talk, Soam. You never disappoint. So, it's been a great, great talk. And you've broken records of all kinds on Cancer Academy. So we will be calling you again and again. So you broke our,
Dr. Vijay Ahuja, Rohit, Ashwin, Ramya, Amit, our full team, Dr. Priya, Jyotsna, all our team, you know, they are working, and you told, you know, they avoid me when they see me.
Yeah, so that's very generous of you, you know, that you're recounting and you're acknowledging all the work that your team is doing. I think that's a great gesture on your part. And like I said, I could not get into Zoom. I could not hear the beginning of your thing because it had crashed, you know, 100 people already there.
100 people, you leave the seat, you cannot be able to come back.
Then I went to YouTube, and there, fortunately, there is no upper limit. There were already 82 people there as well, you know. So it's been a huge, huge, I think the biggest success story for the Cancer Academy so far. And I think, so I told Shubham with Som, you know, you're not going to go wrong at all. Because
I had a very tough, meeting from 5 to 8. One more.
This is something that I have to tell you about Som, that Som runs on, I don't know what he runs on, what he eats, what he drinks. He's got endless amount of energy. This is something that, you know, you should pick up other than what he's just taught you. The dynamism of Som and the energy that he brings on the table and his ability to multitask. He is a phenomenon, you know. There is plenty to learn from him. I have just been zapped, you know, all these years of watching him.
He was actually logged in at 8:10 p.m. already. So most of us teachers log in at 8:25. I have to call them that, please log in. But sir was there already at 8:10.
No, my resident fondly tell that don't take seat in Manipal under Som, because he will first teach you to survive with air and water and later without that in your residency.
So he's the first one to enter every place. So I think he's omnipresent. So there are clones of Som around, if I'm not mistaken. And you know, like I said, there were records broken in terms of attendance and in the number of people who took part in the quiz today. So wow, we had really? A whopping 32 people who participated in the quiz. And the number of people who got it right was also a first. So we had... So
let us have the answers first.
Yeah, let's have the answers first.
You know, okay, you have to give the credit to Sanjeev also, because he made the quiz a bit easy. You know, I...
No, but I think Sanjeev should go through the answers and prizes and other, I think.
So let him do the answers and then I'll tell you who got it right, because I've tabulated them. Go for it, Sanjeev.
Sanjeev, yes.
Not my fault fully. Almost all the questions were answered during sir's presentation. And he, you know, specifically, you know, he gave stress at where the answers were, you know, he answered the question.
go ahead, Sanjeev.
But I'll tell you, I didn't go through the quiz purposely, because I didn't catch it. You know, I just overheard a part of it, but I didn't see the questions even though it was there. Unbiased, I just put it. Maybe important points were the points which were brought in quiz, I think.
So Sanjeev has been kind to everybody, because the earlier moderators were not very kind. They gave very really tough questions. So go for it, Sanjeev.
Sanjeev.
Yeah, so can I see the questions?
Oh, you can't see it? Sorry, yeah. Sorry. Just a second. Oh, I didn't share the screen. Sorry. Just a second. Okay, can you see it now, Sanjeev?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, the first question, the best modality to assess PCI is surgical, and that is laparoscopy. In radiological, MRI, as I said.
Contrast enhanced MRI. Again, contrast enhanced.
Contrast MRI. So next one, what is the extent of peritonectomy in CRS? So it depends on the extent of peritoneal involvement and also on histology. Next. So the optimal duration and temperature during HIPEC is 42 to 43 degrees Celsius for 90 minutes. So the landmark trial, which was published in NEJM last year, was by Van Rell, which is also called OVE-HIPEC. And it is for post NACT setting. So the chemotherapeutic agent used for HIPEC in colorectal cancer is both oxaliplatin and mitomycin.
Okay, Dr. Geeta, the those who
got the answer. So I said, like, 32 people participated in the quiz. And of them, despite the fact that the quiz was easy, four of them got it all right. So I'll just read out the names of the ones who got it right. So Madhu Narayana Basavatarakam from Indo-American got it right.
So your iPhone 12 is on way from Geeta. Please wait.
That will come only from you, so we But we will get to the prize bit. I'm sure September will see us giving out some form of recognition for the people who participate so regularly. Dr. Rohit from Manipal Hospital, I'm sure that is Soam's colleague. And then there is Dr. Shafiq from MDR Cancer Center and Research Institute, Kozhikode. Dr. Ramya from Apollo Mysore. So these are the four people who got all four answers right. So I can't go to the list of 12 others who got four out of the five right. So it's been a great performance. And like I said, you know, Soam has absolutely stolen the show, and you've set the bar very high. We don't know what to do for the next one because you really.
I think the recording would be on the YouTube. So
yes, it will be available, sir. I'll upload it tomorrow.
Whenever you do it, send the link. So I will put to our students so who can.
Most definitely.
And without doing that, I'm sure there'll be a lot of hits on the YouTube. Also.
But the best part was that, you know, most of it, although the last few slides, sir, went a little fast, but most of it is there on the recording. So if anybody wants to create an answer, they just have to pause it on that part and then go through the studies which sir mentioned, all tabulated. So you don't have to go through. You just identify the study, the right one, and then read about it. So that is the beauty of having it on the YouTube, that you can repeatedly see it, slow it down, pause it, read it again, come back to it. And that is how we want to propagate this teaching part also, by getting the best of the faculty online with us.
See, the entire talk I have kept evidence-based medicine. I have not allowed my personal bias to creep in, even though a subject of your passion very easy to get carried away. That's why I have not written anything on the slide without a reference below. And I have not made a statement, anything without a paper to do it. And those which I believe but not proved, I kept it clearly telling they're not part of evidence.
Soam, when you had just done about 11 cases of HIPEC, I think that was about 6 years ago. And he was telling me all the kind of complications. And there was a doctor you talked to me about who had a long post-op stay.
What is the story? She stayed in hospital 92 days.
Yes.
Recurrent ovary. Three times operated, three times recurred, and then she came. She's my longest survivor. 7 years, 3 months, today disease-free she is. She's a doctor from Davangere.
Yeah, she told me that. Yeah.
All of my HIPEC conference, she comes and speak on this. So she had such complications. I had to do stoma, then I closed the stoma. Today, stoma closed, she is eating, put on weight. She came for follow-up about 1.5 months before, in spite of COVID. 7 years, 3 months. Three-time recurrent ovary. I have never had a patient who lived so long recurrent for 7.5 years. She is my patient who lived, and she comes all my conference. she taught everything for our group. We learned everything about, that's why we brought 7 papers on only morbidity in HIPEC before we brought survival.
So I remember you telling me that you saw everything possible in her, meaning, you know, all the possible complications of HIPEC. And you've come a long way since then. You know, you've published so much on HIPEC. You are an internationally recognized, entity in HIPEC.
We're only as good as our team, and I share a very good team, so which I don't do anything. I just show the direction, and really they go and do the manual work for that. So I'm only as good as my team, and they're excellent people.
That's great.
Even though they avoid me, looking at me, that what new paper comes to me, and then I can.
So that is very, very inspiring. So, you know, there's lots to learn from Soam, and I'm sure we'll have him back again because he, you know, we have to ask this final question, kis chakki ka khate ho? Because, you know, there is so much he can share with you. It's not funny. This is only one aspect of his personality.
When I come to Delhi, when you take me for a nice aloo paratha, then I'll tell you the secrets.
So it's not only about HIPEC. I think he delves into every single system that is there in oncology and does a great job of it. So it's been great having you on board, Soam. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
And we'll meet again next time. And this time, let's come down to finding out how it is to get into statistics of things, and we'll be having Dr. Priya. Is that right, Shubham?
Yeah, Dr. Priya Ranganathan. She'll be talking on. So we are trying to club some topics, especially the forest plot and stuff. And we have requested Madam to take, 4 or 5 lectures, and she'll try to cover as much stats as possible, which is required for us to know, especially in cancer. So next Wednesday is with Dr. Priya, but the topic, I'll let you know, she just kept the topic that she'll club 4 topics, odds ratio, p-value and stuff like that. But it's going to be a very interesting talk. We should have the topic by tomorrow evening. So I'll post that on the group. So I think that's for today. And thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sanjeev.
Thank you, Sanjeev.
Thank you. There was a lot of senior faculty here. Dr. Deekshit, Dr. Chandramohan, Dr. Rudra, Dr. Rama Joshi, Dr. Bafna.
So,
we had almost so many people logging in.
You being tracked, man.
Yes.
No. They are all my seniors. They will see, okay, score. they are the one who helps me improve myself. So
they have given me a 10 on 10. Don't worry. They've given me a 10 on 10. And I think I'm sure everybody shares the same sentiment. Thank you, Sanjeev, for moderating this session and putting through a very interesting quiz. I'm sure we all learned in the process, and we'll see you again for the next edition of a Cancer Academy lecture on Wednesday, 8:30 p.m.
Thank you.
Thank you. And good night.